who found himself at this lake. And he felt very uneasy to be back there, all the more so when he spotted some lifeguards out on the water and they were digging something out of the water, fishing it out. And it was a corpse. It was a corpse of a 12-year-old girl. And Harold took one look at that corpse and he knew immediately who it was. It was his lifelong friend, his childhood friend, Tally. And years ago, they'd been in the lake together and they used to play every day in this lake until one day, Tally walked into the lake and she never came out again. And here he was, 20 years old, and here was Tally's body exactly as it had looked 10 years ago. And he was utterly horrified by the fact that he had suffered the ravages of time and his dear friend hadn't. Now, that's a piece of fiction from Ray Bradbury. And that was a story I could never get out of my head when I first heard about the twin paradox. Now, I'm sure you all know the twin paradox, but just to go through it very briefly, it's something that you'd observe on Earth if you were watching two twins on Earth. And one of them stayed with you, the one we can see here, and the other took a really fast trip on a spaceship, for example. Because the person that was the speedy twin relative to you and her siblings, for her, time would slow down. Time dilation would happen. So when she came back, she'd look as fresh as a daisy, and you and her sibling would be much, much older. You'd show the ravages of time. And it's the thing we call the twin paradox. But of course, in the sort of earthly speeds that we can run, you know, things like jumbo jets and things like that, yes, this time dilation happens, as Einstein predicted, but it's by tiny, tiny amounts, you know, fractions of a billionth of a second. So it's lovely to have fiction like that beautiful story, so that we can get a sense of how it would feel if it was sort of played out rather larger. And I love the story called The Lake, Ray Bradbury's story The Lake, because there wasn't any supernatural happening, and there wasn't even a rocket. All that happened was that a strange series of events had forced this man, Harold, to flip out of his sort of quotidian idea of time and see the sort of time's arrow anew. And I would say that Harold's experience was uncanny. Now, I'm a roboticist, and the uncanny is something that we talk about an awful lot. And some of you may be familiar with the sort of more usual way that we talk about the uncanny. And it's usually about the way that we approach human-like objects, like this doll. The idea of the uncanny valley, for example, is very simple. We like human-like objects because they like us, they feel familiar. We feel empathy for them. But if they start to become a little too human-like, something strange happens. We start to find them very sort of fear-inducing and almost uncomfortable making it, and maybe even disgusting, as you may start to feel uncomfortable looking at this doll. Now, the uncanny valley thing in robotics, very contentious theory, but actually it's part of a far more venerable idea about this, something that we talk about, the uncanny, or the Unheimliche, something that goes right back to the 19th century. Now, the uncanny is that sort of delicious feeling you get when something familiar takes on a very, very strange cast. And there are sort of classic uncanny objects like this. This is a dead dad. It's not actually human. It's one of Moek's beautiful pieces. It's actually about that big if you've never seen it, dead dad. And you know, this is the classic idea of the uncanny, as in it's human, but it seems strangely not so, because it isn't. And it's dead, but it's strangely not so because it somehow seems to be unbuffeted by the sort of ravages of time. And you could say that Moek's work is very uncanny because it ties into this very old idea of the uncanny, which is the idea of the doppelganger, the sort of double. And we've always found doppelgangers or doubles something that we find rather strange, like these famous Grady twins in The Shining. And in fact, these sorts of creatures hark back to much, much older ideas in folklore. For instance, the doppelgangers who lived outside of time that were known as the revenants. Now, we have revenants in the British Isles. We've had them in our folk history for donkey's years. And there's a beautiful song about Usher's Well, for example, where a mother loses her three sons. And one day there's a knock at the door and these creatures come back and they're her sons, perfectly preserved like they were all those years ago. And The only reason that she realises it's not them is because they don't eat, because they're dead. And I love all these ideas in folklore, and I love the way that they chime so beautifully with ideas in physics, because what are these twins if not doppelgangers? And what are they if not uncanny? Because how uncanny it must be for either twin to see their sibling after they've done this bit of travel. And in a way, I sometimes feel that with many things in physics and with technology, we can become a little bit sort of blasé about it. And sometimes it's nice to be able to sort of feel the full sort of visceral force of the strangeness of it, which I think that folklore helps us to do. Of course, this is fact, this isn't fiction. You know, if you take any time, as we were just hearing earlier, is this sort of fluid thing. And all the time dilations are happening with one thing relative to another. But when we go to fiction, things like the lake, that time dilation is another thing altogether. And of course, as I say, in the lake, there was nothing supernatural, there were no rockets, but Tally, the girl, had to die for this strange dilation of one person's life to another to happen, to get that sense of discontinuity, of time slip. And we've played with that idea of time slip a lot in folklore and in fiction. And of course, before we had rockets and before we had, you know, Einstein's theories and things like that, we just kind of used to fall asleep for a very long time to create the sense of one person's time falling out of sync with other people's, which of course is what happened with Sleeping Beauty. And happened more recently in this beautiful book. I don't know if any of you know this, Looking Backward. You can get it online for free in the Gutenberg Library online. 1887 it was written. Beautiful story by Edward Bellamy. And this chap is very restless and he can't get to sleep. So who does he get in? He gets in Dr. Pillsbury, an animal magnetism professor. And Pillsbury mesmerises him and he falls asleep in 1887. And when does he wake up? The year 2000. And it's just, you have to read it. It's so prescient and it's just so beautiful. For instance, nobody has umbrellas anymore because of this sort of sense of community. Everybody shops in these covered walkways. So I mean, basically what he's describing was Milton Keynes Shopping Centre. And many, many beautiful things. There is a sort of fledgling idea of an internet in this book, if you're interested. You go to a shop and what you actually see are cards written by the government with instructions about what you can buy and what you can do with it. And then you press buttons and the products, actually this is stealing a march on the internet, the products actually come through pneumatic tubes to you. And so it's just a beautiful, beautiful book. Really, really interesting in tune to all this stuff. But something less beautiful that was around in my youth, going back to this idea of thinking about the past, was this. Now, there was a book that was around when I was a kid, and it also dealt with time travel, and it also had to deal with it through fiction. And it was this beautiful comic book called Misty. Now, did anybody know Misty here? Anybody? Probably showing my age. Oh yeah, well great, it's lovely, isn't it? Yeah. And it didn't last long, and I think it kind of wasn't hit in the usual market, because the thing about Misty, there was a very sort of popular magazines like Jackie and all that were around in the early 80s, but Misty was a bit more special than that, because it was like Jackie but with a supernatural twist. And so you didn't just snog somebody down the disco, you snogged them down the ghost disco, things like that. Really, really good. Anyway, this version, so my dear friend Ian Hodgson gave me this particular copy of Misty, and it is super, it's got the most fantastic time travel story in it. Very dystopian, very, very different to Bellamy's book, and it very much plays on the themes that were going around in our heads very genuinely when I was a kid. Because it's called Home for Tea. Home for Tea, very beautiful. What's her name? I think Addie and her friend in their cosy moorland cottage, and they go off to go potholing. Don't worry, Mum. We'll be home for tea. But then something happens. They go potholing and there's a rock fall and they get stuck down there. And then something happens. Their watches stop. Time passes. Eventually they can find a way out. And when they get outside, there's been a nuclear war. And not only a nuclear war, but a vast amount of time has passed. And here she is going, oh, what's this? Is it snow? No, it's radioactive fallout. And, oh, look, that's all that's left of our cottage. It's a really interesting story. It goes on and on. I urge you to read it. And it ends with them finding their mother's grave. Their mother is long, long dead. So here we are, a beautiful example of time travel, where the children are using time travel as a sort of fantasy to engage with a thing that was genuinely worrying. Because when I think about time travel in the 80s, I genuinely didn't think I would be here to be telling you this story. Because in our mind, reaching your 40s was a fantasy, because in absolute seriousness, we were quite under the impression that we wouldn't be here because of the bomb. So this was sort of playing with the sort of themes of the time. And it's no wonder that these stories of time travel are so compelling, because, well, we're just sort of locked, aren't we? We're locked into the sort of quotidian, everyday, you know, the sort of clocks of our bodies. And it's a very, very compelling fantasy to pretend otherwise, as this person has done, this canonised person. He's another dead dad, actually. I shouldn't say that, but he's a padre. And I think we can salute the embalmer's art here and the technology of the lead-lined coffin, which was often the case with these sort of interesting cases where people were coming out perfectly preserved. Now, I was interested, again, in time travel as a kid, in something that used to crop up very, very regularly on British television on a Saturday afternoon, and it was another uncanny creature who had also managed to somehow create an exquisite time dilation of her own, and it was, of course, Ursula Andress. Now, some of you may know Ursula's work. One of her greatest films in her oeuvre was, of course, She Who Must Be Obeyed. She was a sort of dominatrix, immortal goddess woman. And the way she got her immortality was she bathed in the eternal flame, which you can see her doing here with her lover. And she invited him into the eternal flame. Now, I don't know if anybody's seen this film. Brilliant film. So here she is. This is very early Hammer special effects. So here she is in the eternal flame. It's all going tickety-boo. But and he's bathing in there too. But of course, what happens? Oh no, she's gone in there twice. What happens? The effect of the eternal flame is, as Peter Cushing is showing us, is reversing, and she's seriously, I think the expression is hagging out. Brilliant, absolutely. Honestly, this was so disturbing when I was a kid. And actually, the memory of it, I was on a bit of a loop with this last night. The memory of it was slightly better than the actuality. But as you can see, she loses her immortality. And I think this is very interesting, because this is a theme that often comes up in stories about time travel. Time travel is this uncanny thing, it's this sublime thing. But in anything sublime, anything uncanny, there's always the hint of your own destruction, which of course is what our dear friends Addy and co were talking about, and of course this fellow here. Now, of course, the wonderful thing about celluloid is that there is no destruction. The celluloid captures Ursula in all her glory in those early, early days. It is her eternal flame, if you like. Unlike the real Ursula herself, who's doing absolutely brilliantly. I mean, I really hope I look that good, so I've top of her head off there. I really hope I look that good when I'm her age, but clearly she hasn't been in the eternal flame. And that's something that she actually is quite happy to have a bit of a laugh about. I don't know if you can see here, but this is her a film premiere. Here's Ursula now with a composer, actually, and she's got Ursula then on a t-shirt, and she's having a bit of a laugh. So there she is. It's almost like sort of twin paradox all again. There she is, visiting this other self that exists in this other realm. And, of course, when we think about the Grady sisters, this is how we remember them, isn't it? There they are, captured in a series of perfect freeze frames, as they were all those years ago. And of course, actually, now they're fully grown women, and one of them, I think the one on the left, is a microbiologist. But now this might all seem like the bleeding obvious, and of course it is, but you have to remember that it wasn't always the case that you could preserve people in this sort of suspended state where you could sort of revisit them and see what they were like, you know, sort of recording. And in the early days of photography and sound recording, people became very exercised about this and what it might mean, as did these three sisters, only two of whom were actually living when this photo was taken. And this was very much a thing, the post-mortem photograph in the early days of, you know, domestic photography. And there's a suggestion here, going back to this idea of sort of stopping the ravages of time. There was a suggestion that if somehow you could capture that photo, somehow you were capturing something, you were sort of blurring the boundaries between the living and the dead. And actually this only went out of fashion as the embalmer's art came to the fore in the 1860s and 70s, and corpses were being hurried out of the house before they got, well, quite frankly, stinky, and they started pumping them with all the junk that they pumped them with for the last few decades. Now, here's another sleeper of sorts, a sort of something that slept and sort of bucked the sort of time's arrow, if you like. And again, this might seem ordinary to us, but when this was first heard, it was considered extraordinary. This is a recording, a sound recording that was lost for about 40 years and was rediscovered in about 1930. And this is what it sounded like. Nightingale. If anybody's interested, I'll play it again later. But what was interesting, that Florence Nightingale in 1990, one of the very first sort of celebs, if you like, to record her voice, and she recorded it on wax. And she only had 2 minutes to make a recording. And in those 2 minutes, what she actually spoke about was the fact that this recording would outlive her. The fact that when I'm no longer memory, even a name, I hope my voice may perpetuate the great work of my life. So again, she was very exercised about the idea that technology was allowing people to live out some kind of a fantasy, allowing them to hear voices of people who had gone. And I'll leave you with this before I go into the music. In Scientific American in 1877, they heard the very first demonstration of Edison's phonograph, the very first machine that could record and playback sounds, and it was on tin foil. And Scientific American reporter said that it had not escaped their notice that with this device, the voices of the dead can be reheard. And the great singers like Titians and others, their voices will not die with them, but will stay with us until the actual tin itself decays. And this was a really, really big deal. And of course now, with sound technology, as I've got here, we can really, really play with time's arrow. You know, we can not only capture sound and have sound outlive people and other things outlive people, sort of live a fantasy through technology, but we can also sort of manipulate that sound and play with sound very, very flexibly. So I'm going to do a couple of pieces now, just to give you a little idea. So I hope the desk is going to be okay. So yes, I should point out this is the Ealing Feeder. It's going to be quite quiet today, and it's based on a panel in Battersea Power Station. But anyway, here goes.
The silence of causing occur by means of one's will. In magic, there is neither good nor evil. It is merely a science. The science of causing change to occur by means of one's will. In magic, there is neither good nor evil. It is merely a science. The science of causing change to occur by means of one's will.
Thank you.
apocalyptic sound system there.